Then we're gonna pull up John 7 to 38. John chapter 3, verse 15 to 13. And then John 7, verse 38. And if you have your Bibles, if somebody is next to you that does not have theirs, if they are willing and wanting to, share your Bible with them. But if not, it is on the monitors for everyone to read. That way you won't be able to say, I made up anything. Forget what this preacher has to say. Let it come from the word of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. And so the word of God reads, in verse 14 of John 3, it says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. That whosoever, somebody say whosoever, believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let's look at John chapter 7, verse 38. And the word of the Lord reads, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said. Notice how you have to believe on the Lord. As the scripture is said. Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. My title this morning may sound different to you, but it says, I may not understand all, but I believe. I may not understand it all. I may not understand it all, Lord, but I believe. You hear what I'm saying? We may not understand everything that God is doing, but we got to believe. Let us pray. Let us ask God to help us. Father God, we thank you. We give you glory, we give you honor. For we have read your holy scriptures. Right now, God, I believe every word that proceeded out of your mouth. Father, I may not understand it, God, all things, but Lord God, I believe your word. Father, I pray, help us today. Give us understanding, revelation, illumination, God. I pray in the name of Jesus that the scriptures, the word, will come off the page, God, and come alive right before us. Oh, ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. You shall live, you shall not die. For hear the word of God, the Lord, for is alive. And Father, right now I ask that you will save somebody today. Touch us today, oh God. I bind every spirit of distraction, everything that is not like you, God, every demon from hell that wanted to show up, God, today, to Lord God, to take the seed. I plead the blood of Jesus right now on every mind and every heart. Father, that we will surrender today, that the Holy Ghost will come alive in somebody's life today. Trouble the waters of baptism. For we love you, Lord, and we thank you, and we appreciate you for all that you have done. Somebody just open up their mouth and just say, thank you, Lord. Just somebody say, Lord, I may not understand all, but I believe. You may be seated. In Jesus' name. I may not understand it all, but I believe. This is something that, Lord, had touched my heart over this past couple of days. That I want souls of men to be saved. I want all of Belgrade and the Glade area to be saved. I wish I could baptize everybody in this whole Glade area. You were saying, Pastor, how are you going to do all that? I don't know. But I believe I can. I want everybody that lives in an apartment or house to hear this message of what they must do to be saved. I want your family, if they live somewhere in the islands, somehow I want them to hear this message. What must they do to be saved? Do I believe that I can do it myself? No, not this human man. But I believe God can do it through me. And so there are many things that we really can explain or really understand. Well, you say, what is that? Well, for example, if you can explain it, then good, talk to me about it then. But I cannot really explain the human body. I can't really explain how the human body, how it works, and all of the things that functions in the human body. Now, you can tell me certain things if you are into medicine and if you're into that practice and everything like that, but you don't really understand how God made it and how it's working like that. Amen. How you're able to see out of your eye and the pupils and all of these things that you're looking at me right now, or you're looking ahead at what's ahead of you. You really don't understand how that is actually working, but you're able to see. The nerve system, how that nerve system, how your head, when it itches, something brings a sign from your head to your hand to say, scratch your head, and now you're scratching it. But it happens that quick. Nobody can really explain that. You might be able to give me some type of things that you've learned scientifically, but you really don't understand it totally. I don't understand how the sun stays exactly where it is and never draws close to the earth to burn it up. We have some hot days here. Hot days here in Florida. Some days it almost seems like the sun is just sitting on your shoulder. But you ain't being burnt up. I don't understand that. But I believe God put it in place. I don't understand how the trees give us oxygen. You breathe it freely. But do you know where that's coming from? The trees. You might know the chemical and know the chemical balance of all of that, but you really don't understand it. That you're breathing right now because of the trees that God has set in place. And I don't understand how a seed, you plant a seed or an acorn. That acorn can be planted in the ground. And that seed that is planted over a period of time, somehow it begins to take form and root. Somehow that seed begins to take some form. We don't see it yet, but all of a sudden, as it is growing underneath the ground, sometime or some period, it pops out and we see the budding of a tree. Now you can tell me the biological things, but you really don't understand. And so there's some things that we may not understand. There's some things that I may not understand about what God is doing in my life. There's some things I may not understand what's happening in your life. But I just believe that God knows all things, and he created all things, and all things were made by him. And without him, nothing was ever made. I believe that you're breathing, that the life that you have, that God made a specific way for you to get here to this church today to hear the word of God. He orchestrates everything in our life for a reason. I don't understand it, but brother, I believe it. I believe it. I believe that God has a plan for everybody in this city, everybody in this world. You're not just something that he just threw together. You're not something that he just made, but you were beautifully, you were marvelous, you were wonderfully made. And so there's a reason for your life. There's a reason why you're breathing. There's a reason why you're here. There's a reason why you've got the family here. There's a reason why you're in the house of the Lord. But somebody needs to say, Lord, I may not understand it now, but I believe you have a calling for my life. I believe you want me to be saved. I believe there's a reason why I'm still alive. There's a reason why you're still here and family members are gone. There's a reason why you're still and you made it out of that relationship. There's a reason why you're still here. Why that accident didn't kill you. There's a reason why the drugs didn't overtake you. There's a reason why you're not behind bars. There's a reason why God saved you. There's a reason. You may not understand God, but I believe God. And so I begin to look at the scriptures concerning, we don't understand how God does things. Because the scripture in Isaiah 55 verse 8 through 9 Notice what the Bible says. For my thoughts are not your thoughts. Notice what God says. Neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, notice what God says, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So many times we get frustrated, and many times we go to God and say, God, I need you to do this. God says, no, that's not my time, and that's not what I want to do. But God, I need this, no. But Lord, why? Why? Because he says, you know what? My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. There's some things you're not going to understand why God is doing it. There's sometimes you're not going to understand why God is putting this in your life, but in due season you shall find out, or maybe on that great day you'll find out. But that does not mean you should give up. That does not mean you should throw in the towel. You got to say, God, I don't understand it, but yet I will trust you, yet I will believe, yet I will keep walking, yet I will keep saying, Lord God, I love you, not let anything come between me and you. So I don't understand all that God does. I just have to believe all the things work together for my good. That's why, because we don't understand, it's hard for us many times to get a healing. And I believe somebody in here is in need of a healing today. I believe that somebody is in need of a healing today. You can say, well, I'm all right, no, the devil is a lie. Why don't we be real today? That if you need God to do something for you, just lift up your hands and let him know. God, I need you to do something for me today. Lord, I'm not going to hold back, but I do need you to do something for me today. And this is what blows our minds about God, that he defies science. He defies gravity. He defies nature. When the doctor says that you have cancer and you are on your last stage, then suddenly God can say, not so. And then something switches around where you go back to the doctor and the doctor says, I don't see any signs of cancer. I don't know what happened. I don't know how this happened. It wasn't a drug. It wasn't no chemo. It wasn't no radiation. But it was God that did it. God, but yet I believe. I believe. I believe. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. And when you try to put your wisdom and your knowledge next to the scripture, it's going to sound foolish. Foolish. Notice the blind beggar in John chapter 9. Verse 6 through 11. Let me see how you react to something like this. The Bible says, make it simple in the NLT version so that we can understand. Then he spit on the ground, made mud with the saliva, and spread the mud over the blind man's eye. Now many of us right there would have a problem. Right there, he said, Jesus, what you about to do with that spit? Because you ain't putting that up on me. Could you go over to the water fountain? Could you go get some water and put that in your hands? Why you got to spit on it? You see how the logic we got to say? Because you know spit is germs. You understand what I'm saying? That's bacteria. You don't put that up on people. Matter of fact, I swing on people. Jesus, don't get swung on. I swing on people that spit on me. That's how we would be. But notice what verse 7 said. He told him, go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam. Siloam means sent. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. His neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, isn't this the man who used to sit and beg? And notice what it says. Some said he was the other said, no, he just looks like him. But the beggar kept saying, yes. I'm the same one. Yep. I'm the one. I'm the one that was over there that couldn't see. I'm the one. They asked the question, who healed you? And what happened to you is what I want to know. And notice the testimony that he began to say. He told them that the man they called Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash yourself. So I went and washed, and guess what? Now I can see. What am I saying? I didn't understand what he was doing, but I believe. rationalize what God wants you to do. Somebody lift up your hands and say, God, heal me today, I believe. And it goes to us today. It goes to us today. I can start to shout right now. Because I remember I was a sinner. I remember my lifestyle. I remember what I used to do. I'm not walking around talking about I'm a heaven, an angel from heaven. The devil is a lie. Any preacher that tell you that, he's a lie. But I thank God for what he brought me out of. Notice what I just said. He brought me out of it, which means I'm not still in it. I'm out of it. But I thank God for bringing me out of that mess. Because I was a sinner. And I'm going to try to get to you where you are today. Pull up 1 Corinthians chapter 6 at verses 9. Because many of us, as I say, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Come on, people of God. We are family. Because when I call your number, you can just lift up your hands. Notice what it says. Be not deceived. Or don't deceive yourself. Because we all have fallen short to the kingdom of God. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate or homosexuals, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Look at what the Bible says in verse 10. Not these, any thieves right now, not covetous, not drunkards. You get tipsy on the weekend. I like to get ready to preach right now. No revilers, people that like to party all day long. No extortionists shall inherit the kingdom of God. But let me tell you, I used to be a sinner. But guess what happened? I don't know how he did it, but I don't know how he did it. Because he said such was some of you. But guess what happened, minister? But we were washed. But we were sanctified. But we were justified. Clap your hands up to God. But Jesus did it to you. I don't know how he did it. But I believe he did it. I don't know how the change came, but it came. I don't know how the cursing stopped, but I stopped cursing. I don't know how the alcohol got out of my body, but I don't like alcohol no more. I don't know how the smoke stopped, the cigarettes or the Newports, but I don't smoke it no more. Matter of fact, I get sick when I smell it, because God knows how to drag you away from that thing, from that sin, that make you hate it, to make you say, I can't stand it. That's what I'm talking about, people of God. God is real. You just got to believe. Tell your neighbor you got to believe. So let us look at three points regarding this message today. Here are the three points this morning. Number one, we got to move forward. Number one, you got to move forward. It is the devil's job to keep us standing. It is the devil's job to keep you from growing in God. It is the devil's job to stop the church of the living God from going forward. It is the devil's job that you will say, no, I'm not going to go to that altar today. It is the devil's job. He already said, okay, they're going, but we got to do something before they actually get their lives right with God. It is the devil's job to talk to you right now while I'm preaching the word of God and while you're hearing the word of God to get your mind distracted about what you got to do when you leave here. It is the devil's job to make you start thinking about tomorrow. It is the devil's job to make you start talking to your neighbor because he doesn't want you to hear this thing. But I come to tell you, don't allow that devil to keep you holding your back, but you got to move forward. You can't stay where you are. Come on, it's a new year. I know you probably made your new year resolution, and you might have said, well, I've already broken. Just get back in line, people of God. Just get back on track and begin to move forward. Just begin to move forward, people of God. And so this is what the Bible lets me know, that the devil tries to put fear in our lives. Distractions begin to come up. But when you try to get back with God, you got to understand what we do, people of God. We walk by faith and not by sight. How many know the word of God? But I begin to notice the scripture. I like giving scripture because that's how I base my salvation on what the Bible Bible says and not what some man says. But the Bible, as we know in Exodus chapter 14 verse 10 to 12. Notice what the Bible says. I like keeping it simple. I love the KJV, the Authorized Version. But I make it simple so we can all understand. As a Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and panicked. When they saw the Egyptians overtaking them, they cried out to the Lord. And notice what took place from there, people of God. As they began to cry out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness, Pastor Moses? Why did you ever give us the word that God was able to deliver us? Why did you ever tell us that God was going to deliver us out of Egypt? Why did you ever tell us that God wanted to deliver us? Why did you ever tell me, Pastor, that God said he could save me, even though I was in some mess, and even though I was a slave to sin? Why did you ever come and give me a Bible study? Why did you ever lay hands upon me? Why did you ever tell me to go down in the name of Jesus in the waters of baptism? Why did you tell me don't get baptized in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost? Why did you tell me to do it in Jesus' name? Why is that the saving blood name? Why is that the name, Pastor? Why did you tell me to do that? Because don't know what they said. Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What they have done, you done to us. And why did you make us leave Egypt? Notice what they're saying. They're complaining about their deliverance. They're saying, oh my God, we've been delivered, but look what's ahead of us. We got the Red Sea in front of us. We got mountains on the left and the right of us. And we got this devil called Pharaoh coming in behind us. Now he's going to really kill us. Now he's going to really take our lives. Now we are really going to die. But don't you understand that same God that brought you out is the same God that's going to bring you in. That same God that saved you on that day is the same God that's going to keep you until the day that we see his glorious face. Somebody got to believe it even if you don't understand it. In the name of Jesus. And so I begin to look at the Red Sea and I taught Bible studies and I asked many of them. I said, now if the sea had to turn it away like this, how many would have went down into the Red Sea or the Red Sea riverbed? How many would have started to walk? How many would have saw the walls go up on the left and right? And then now you're going through. Many I said, I don't know, because I see the walls, but maybe the walls may fall down. And that's how we are today. That many times we don't step out on faith. And many times you don't step out because you're thinking, what if he doesn't do it? What if it doesn't go like that? And what if it doesn't happen? Or what if I go back to doing that sleeping stuff? What if I go back laying with her? What if I go back to drinking? What if I go back to clubbing? What if I go back to doing this? I'm telling you, listen, it ain't about what you think. I just have to believe what God's word said he will do. You may not understand the people of God, but you better believe it. In the name of Jesus. Come on, clap your hands up to God. While I finish reading the scripture, in Exodus chapter 14, look at what the Bible says in verse 13. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not. That's how the pastor has to do. People, listen, stop fearing. Stop fearing. Stand still and see the salvation or the deliverance of the Lord, which he will show you today. I just come to tell somebody that you need to watch and see what happened today. That you need to see God's glory take place in your life today. Somebody just tell two people right now that you need to pay attention today. Tell them real quick, pay attention today. In the name of Jesus. And notice for the Egyptians whom you see today, that problem that you facing today, that sickness that you facing today, those problems in your household that you're facing today, that marriage problem that you're facing today. Come on, people of God, hear the word of the Lord. For the Egyptians whom we have seen today, you shall see them again. Guess what he says? No more. Somebody say no more. No more. But guess what he adds on to that? Forever. No more and for what? Forever. In the name of Jesus. Somebody say forever. I say forever. And verse 14 says, the Lord shall fight for you. Really, Lord? You don't fight for me now. So stop trying to do the windmill. Stop trying to fight in your sleep. Stop trying to fight them down the street. Stop trying to do the windmill. Stop trying to fight yourself because you're going to lose that one. And if you think you're a boxer, stop trying to square up. Stop trying to fight and keep your mouth closed. I know you want to get the last say so, but shut up. Come on, people of God, and let God do it for you. Let God do it for you, fight for you. Because notice what it says. The Lord shall fight for you, and you shall hold your own peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Look at the man of God. Lord, he's going back to God. Say, Lord, now you told me to go and let them know that you're going to do this thing. So don't let me look like no liar. And I definitely don't want you to look like no liar. But if you said it, Lord, it shall come to pass. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore thou criest unto me? Speak unto the children. Okay, Lord, notice what she says. Speak unto the children. And what you want me to tell them, Lord, that they go for it. You got to go for it, people of God. You got to get up out of this cesspool. You got to get up out of that mess. You got to stop doing that stuff. You got to stop hanging around those people. You got to stop hanging around those unbelievers. You got to stop being around those doubters. You got to stop being around those haters. You got to hang up with those people on your phone. You got to delete them off your Facebook. You got to delete them off your Instagram. You got to stop reading that foolishness. Stop reading that horoscope. Talking about this is what the day says don't get me. The devil is a liar. I don't read no horoscope, but I read the word of God. That I am an overcomer. And with all things, with everything that God gives me, I'm able to get it through. Come on, people of God. Somebody got to believe the word of the Lord. Clap your hands unto God if you believe. So notice what he tells the man of God. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea. I wonder how many people go to their situation, whatever their problem is, and go straight to it, stretching out your hands unto God. Or do you sit there, you get ulcers, you get sick, you start feeling depressed, you start going attention, you start getting upset, and that takes out on everybody else. But if you would just believe, you may not understand it, but go to your job one day and just lift up your hands at your cubicle or on your job, or even if you're up in somewhere, a warehouse or wherever you are, just walk straight through and just lift up your hands and say, Lord, I don't know, but I believe. I believe you're going to turn this around. I don't know, God, I don't see how you're going to do it, but I believe. I don't understand, God, what's going to happen, but I believe it. If you need a job, people of God, go to the place where you want to work and say, Lord, I don't know if I got the credentials, but I believe you can allow me to get this job. Lord, I just believe the people of God. But don't just stay there where you are. You got to move forward. And so notice the word of God says, and stretch out thy hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground, though the midst of the sea. And so I begin to think of this thing, that we do not go forward because we're trying to figure out things ourselves. And there's some things that God has said, listen, you're never going to figure it out. That is his job, that he will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. And so what you're doing is trying to figure it out yourself, and you get frustrated, and then we don't see you, and then you say, well, I'm trying to do this, and I keep telling you, listen, stop trying, because you ain't doing nothing like a mouse but running on the Ferris wheel, and you're really not going nowhere. But if you allow God to do it, then you'll start seeing yourself make up some ground, because it ain't you no way, because God wants to receive the glory. That's why I begin to praise God, and that's why we were singing. I was singing and wanted to praise God and take a little time for myself, if you didn't want to praise during that time, because I begin to think about where God has brought me from. I begin to think about the doors that he opened, but I also begin to think about the doors that he closed, that I would not walk into it. I begin to think about that stuff. I begin to think about, you better start thinking about it, the people that he did not let you hook up with, because they would have roped your life up. They would have tore your life up. Can't you think about the things that God kept you from? That's where you want to know how merciful he is, that he'll keep you from some stuff. That's the God I serve. Now don't go ahead and keep you out of some stuff, but he'll keep you from some stuff. People of God, you may not understand, but what am I telling you today? You just got to believe. Which brings me to my second point. Look up and live. Look up and live. In our scripture text, It read in John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. This actually took place after God has shown them so many miracles talking about Israel in the Old Testament. This took place, this serpent being lifted up took place after God has shown them so many miracles. And many people started to complain on their journey. And I want to pick it up in Numbers 21, verse 5. And they began to speak against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die here in the wilderness? They complained. There is nothing to eat here and nothing to drink. And we hate this horrible man. I'm mad because God brought me out of here. I'm mad that I'm in this situation. And you know what? I don't even want to hear what he got to say. I don't want no bread. I'm tired of it. That's how we get. That he'll supply it. But once he supplies it, you still want more. And then we get upset about what he's given us. I'm tired of it. And I don't want no more. But in Numbers 21, verse 6 to 9 says, so the Lord sent poisonous snakes among the people, and many were bitten and died because they complained after God had delivered them out of Egypt, or because we complain after God has taken us out of some things. God has brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. God has brought us into truth when we hear the true word of God. God has taught us some things. We've learned some things. We're growing in God. We're growing in Christ. But because it's not going the way that you feel like that it should go, you start to complain. And the Bible says that God sent poisonous snakes among the people, and many were bitten and died. Then the people came to Moses and cried out. Notice who they're going back to? The pastor. We have sinned, but speaking against the Lord and against you, pray that the Lord will take away the snakes. So notice what Moses did as a pastor. Pray for the people. Then the Lord told him, make a replica of a poisonous snake and attach it to a pole. What? All who are bitten will live if they simply look at it. Notice what it just said. All you got to do is just simply look at it. Now, how many of us would say, what? This is stupid. And this does not make sense. You dying. And all you got to do is just look up. And look at the replica or the bronze snake that he has lifted up. Snakes are all over the place. People are dying. Babies are dying. Your family is dying. And all you got to do is just simply look up. Look at what he told you to do. It does not make sense, people of God. It don't make sense. But if you want to live, you got to look up, people of God. Look to the hills, which come in your help. Your help comes from the Lord. If you put your eyes upon Jesus, if you stop looking around at what's around you, and begin to put your eyes upon Jesus, you shall live and not die. Somebody got to hear the word of God today. Look up and live, people of God. Look up and live, people of God. But don't you know many did not look up, and so many died because of their stubbornness, because they did not want to simply believe what God said to do for their souls to be saved. But watch what God says to us in the New Testament, in John chapter 12, verse 32 to 33. And if I, notice what he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, that's what he says. Notice what he do. If I be lifted up from the earth, would draw all men unto me. And this he said, signify what death that should die. And so don't you understand that our Lord and Savior has already been lifted up. He has been lifted up on that cross. But if you would just go ahead and begin to look upon Jesus, he said that you will be saved. He was born into this world, and he dwelt among us. That was God. God manifested in the flesh. God is a spirit. There is no triune or trinity God that is alive from the pit of hell.
real.
Okay.
That is not true at all.
Okay.
But the Bible lets me know, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord.
Okay.
That Lord Jehovah from the Old Testament, what did he do? He put himself in that flesh that we know as the Christ man Jesus. And what did it say? He dwelt among us. So it's not Jesus Junior. It's not Jesus the second sequel. It's not the second man or the person in the Trinity. But it is God manifested in the flesh. Because God cannot shed blood and God cannot die. But the human man, Jesus Christ, who was God manifested in the flesh, the Bible says that they died and killed him. And when he rose again in the 3 days, he was on that cross and died and rose again. That you and I could have life. That you and I could see another day. That you and I could be saved. And I thank God. I don't understand how you did it, God, but I believe. I don't understand why you did it for me, but Lord, I trust you. I don't understand it, God, but yes, I believe it. I believe it, God, I believe it. I believe it, I believe it. And if you say, I just don't believe it, God, that God came in the flesh, well, let me give you a scripture, because I'm not just going to leave it out here and give you a scripture. Brother, pull up 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. This is the combat power that Paul had with the people. And he just wanted to let you know, if you want to converse or have a problem with me, notice what the Bible says. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. Not little g, but big g. God was manifested in the flesh. I justified in the spirit. Seen of who? Of the angels. And what else? Preach unto the Gentiles. That's who Paul was talking about. Believed on what? In the world. That's how you and I got it. And received of what? Into glory. Somebody may not believe and understand it, but you better believe that here. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Which brings me to my last point. Whosoever that believeth. Tell your neighbor one more time. Whosoever. Whosoever. What's the definition of whosoever? Whoever. Or whatever. Whoever. Or whatever. Whoever. Or whatever. Say it again. Whosoever means whoever and whatever. Whoever in here and whatever in here. I don't know who comes in here, but whatever you are, if you're human, God wants to save you in the name of Jesus. I don't care about what lifestyle you have. I want every lifestyle to come through that door. I ain't got no problem with you. I got a problem with your lifestyle, but God is able to change you. Come on, don't get mad, don't get mad. In the name of Jesus, because you came to a true church, the church of the living God, which is why the scripture says in John chapter 3, verse 16, this don't hit home with no Hebrew Israelites. They try to say only the black or the colored people gonna be saved. The devil is a lie. You better stop reading and listen to their foolishness. That's what I just said. Foolishness. Notice what the Bible says in John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world or the cosmos. That's everything, people of God, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever or whatsoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Ask your neighbor real quick, do you want to perish or do you want to live? Ask him. I just want to know what they're going to say, because it's going to let me know who will come to this altar. If you don't want to live, then go ahead and rock on with your bad self. Did you know that you was bad, bad? You were so bad that you want to chill out with the devil and his angels. But rock on with your bad self and go there. But like I told you, I wasn't invited, so I'm not going to show up. You hear what I'm saying? I got invited to glory's gates. I got invited to heaven. So I believe what he says. That in that new Jerusalem, how many want to go there? To that new Jerusalem, a new place. I tell you right now, the houses we live in today, some of them are falling apart. The apartments we live in today, we need the maintenance man to come and fix something. So what am I telling you? That when we get to new Jerusalem, everything is going to be new. Everything is going to be new. So new that the Bible puts it like this, that the streets are paved with gold. Come on, people of God, that gold you got around your neck and that gold you got in your ears and on your head, that ain't nothing to God. We walking on that stuff in the name of Jesus. It is real stuff. Oh, come on, somebody, hear what I'm saying. So I believe the word of God. I believe the word of God. And that's why Mark 16 and 16 says, he that believeth and is what baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. Which is why the Bible says in John 7, verse 38 to 39, he that believeth on me as the scripture has said, out of his belly, yes, Lord, out of his belly, what's going to happen, God, shall flow rivers of living water. What type of river, Lord? What are you talking about, God? Rivers of living water. What are you talking about? But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. I'm so glad that Jesus has been lifted up and glorified, because I've received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Ask your neighbor, get your gift. Do you got it according to the word of God? I'm so glad I got God's Spirit on the inside. Somebody may say, I got the Holy Ghost too. Do you? Do you got it the way the scripture says? Let me show you what the Bible says before we leave here. Like I said, you got to know the scripture. But take it to me, sir. Acts chapter 2, verses 1. Notice what the Bible says. Acts chapter 2, verses 1. Look at what the Bible says. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all of one accord in one place. Don't it seem like we're doing that today? That's where we are, in one accord in one place. And what? And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And what did it do? And it filled the house where they were sitting. And notice what it says. And they appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and was set upon each of them. And notice what the Bible says. The first time you read where human beings were filled with the Holy Ghost after God told them to go to Jerusalem and wait till you be endued with power from upon high. That power is the Holy Ghost. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. So I want to know what type of Holy Ghost you got. Is it according to scripture? And what they begin to do when they got filled and begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance of the ability. I don't know how God is going to do it, but I just believe that he's going to do it. And I believe it. Why? Because I was filled with the Holy Ghost. And when I got filled with it, I began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave me the utterance. How many believers up in here know what I'm talking about? And so you might say, I just don't get that, because the Bible talks about it in Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, about the nine gifts. This is not the nine gifts, or this is not the diverse kinds of tongues, but this is the gift that will allow you to operate in those gifts. You hear what I'm saying, people of God? So there's something that God does with your tongue. I don't understand it, but I just believe it, according to the scriptures. So God, what are you going to do with this tongue? Why is this tongue? Why is my tongue changing and speaking in another language so important to you? Well, let me explain it to you from the scripture and not my opinion. In the name of Jesus, James chapter 3, verse 7 through 8. For every kind of beast and of birds and the serpent of every thing in the sea is tamed and have been tamed of mankind. But notice what it says, but the tongue can no man tame. It is unruly and evil, full of deadly poison. How many of us covered somebody out yesterday? Oh, how many people said, get out of my face? How many people went off on somebody yesterday? How many people said, I bet you better not do that again? How many people said, do what you want to do then? How many people said, come on, shake the devil and say, Lord, you can say it under your breath and say, in the name of Jesus, how many people use your tongue to do all crazy type of stuff? Oh, somebody know what I'm talking about. How many people kissing on somebody that ain't your husband or wife? Well, I'm going to hit it right there. How many people use this tongue to bless and to curse, which is what the Bible says? Pull it up in verses 9 and 10 and make it simple. Sometimes it praises our Lord and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. Ooh, that's talking about Satan. And so blessings and cursings come pouring out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. Oh, God is not right, you said. God says it's not right. So what do I need to do with that tongue? I'm going to make that tongue that nobody can tame. I'm going to make that tongue speak a heavenly language. That's how bad God is. That thing that seems like it can do what it won't do, God says, I'll grab a hold of that thing and make it speak a heavenly language. In the name of Jesus. So how many people said, Lord, I don't believe it, or I don't understand it, but I believe it. I believe it, God. I believe it, God. And I don't understand that how, God, if I've done all of these bad things, how, God, if I've done so many bad things, if I've done so many bad things, and I really, Lord God, may not have an understanding of what the scripture is saying, and I don't know how you're going to change me, but the preacher and the word of God said you will. So, God, I don't really understand that if I get baptized, how is this water? How is this water right here that has been filled up? How is this water going to wash away all the sins that I have committed in my life? How is God going to do a surgery? How is God going to do a surgery in that water? How is he going to do it? In Galatians chapter 3 verse 27, oh God, I thank you Lord God. In Galatians chapter 3 verse 27, for as many as of you have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. So that when you went down in that watery grave, you came up and you put upon Christ. And with Christ you put on the blood. So when the blood is applied, like the blood was applied on the doorpost in the wilderness with the people of God, that same destroyer, that same angel that is going to come and destroy this place, the Bible says that when he sees the blood, that he will pass over. Somebody may not understand it, but you got to believe it. Somebody might not understand it, but you got to believe it. So what I want to tell you today, believe the word of God. Believe it if you want to be saved. You may not understand it, people of God, but you got to believe it. So the Bible lets me know in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, we're going home right here. Then this is what took place. After Peter preached this wonderful sermon, he was standing with the 11 of them. That means Matthew was standing with Peter when he was delivering this message. And Matthew never butted in and said, wait a minute, Peter. It's okay to do it in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. It's okay to do it like that. Because what Peter was saying, God gave it to him. Because he's the one that Jesus gave the keys to the kingdom. So now watch the keys being opened up. And the Bible says that when they said to Peter, and brethren, what shall we do? What am I to do then? What am I to do then? I don't understand everything, Peter. But what should I do? He said to them, look at what he says. Then Peter said unto them, repent. There's the door unlocking. What else he says? Turn away from your sins. Turn away from that wickedness. Don't go back doing that stuff. Turn away if you want to be saved. And he says, be baptized. Every one of you, what? In the name. Not in the Father, Son, but in the saving name. In the name of Jesus Christ. For what reason, Lord? For the remission or the removal of your sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. But God, you sure? Look at who he's promising this thing. For the promise is unto you. So stop saying that ain't for me. It is unto you and to your children and to all of they that are far off. That's us. Even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Is God calling you today? Yes, he is. Go ahead to verses 40, sir. In the name of Jesus. And with many in other words, or with other words, did he testify and exalt? Notice what he's about to say. You better save yourselves from this untoward generation. You better believe. You better believe if your neighbor don't believe. You better walk up to this aisle if your neighbor don't want to do it. You better come and get your sins washed away if your neighbor don't want to do it. If your girlfriend don't want to do it, you better say, I got to go. If your boyfriend don't want to do it, you got to say, I got to go. If family don't want to do it, if husband ain't here, then you do it because you want to be saved. It's an individual thing. Save yourselves. Come on, people of God, let's stand up right here in the name of Jesus. I just want to know, is there anybody today that believes the word of God? Is there anybody that's here? They may say, Lord, I don't understand everything. I don't know how you're going to do it, but I just believe. So God is wanting to know, is there anybody that believes what he says? Is there anybody that will believe God for your healing? Is there anybody that is believing God that he will save your family? You don't understand how he's going to do it, but just believe. Believe.
someone in here today that have heard God's word, harden not your heart. Hear the word of the Lord today and come that you might have life. He says, I give you life or death. You choose. Do you want to live? My sister, do you want to live? Hear God talking to you right now. My sister, do you want to live? My brother, do you want to live? You may not understand, but believe me. He wants you to live. But you must do something. Because faith without works is dead. So back up what you believe by what you do. You believe, then come. For those who are moving, it's because they believe. But I believe somebody right now is still in the audience. You believe, but you're kind of afraid of people looking at you. But how afraid would you be on that day when you stand before God and He says, you ashamed of me? I'll be ashamed of you. Come and let God fix it. Come and let God fix it. Don't get distracted right now. But come and let God fix it. Come and let God do it. No man in here can save you. No man in here can heal you. Nobody can do anything for you but God. And if God doesn't do it, it's temporary. But if God does it, it's forever. So there's somebody that needs God today. I want you to come. I want you to come. I want you to come. We're going to anoint today. We're going to anoint for those who need something from the Lord. Did anybody told you? It ain't going to work. But He is a liar, the Lord God. He is a liar. Don't believe Him. He's lied to you long enough. He's the father of lies. Don't believe him. Don't let him fool you. Don't let him take you to the lake of fire. That's where he's going. Don't believe him. I want you to live. He wants you to live. And not die. Come on, people of God. Let's live. Let's live. Can we live? I want us to live. Minister, I want you to go and anoint everyone here. And I want you to begin to focus upon Jesus right now. Think about the blood that was shed for you. Think about what He's already done for you. Think about the doors that He's already opened. Think about the blessings He's already given. If He did that, surely He can do it again. Surely He can bless this time. Surely He can save your soul. Surely He can do it. Don't bog your mind down with how is He going to do it. Just believe that He can do it. Because if you don't believe, He won't do it. So if you focus right now upon Jesus, let everybody just close your eyes so you don't have to look to anybody to your left or to your right. It's about just you and God right now. We get distracted because we look at other people. But think about your situation and what you need from God. Think about how bad do you need Him? And what will you say to Him? What will you say to Him? If you need something from God, what will you say? How bad do you need the healing? How bad do you need it? How bad do you need to come out of that?
is your situation? Is it going to cause you to be lost? Then it's real bad. Is that sickness keeping you from doing some things that you want to do? God, we ask that you see us right now and please help us, because we can't help ourselves. We're going to die, God, unless you save us. God, our lives are going to, Lord God, be in the lake of fire if you don't change us. Father, this sickness is going to keep us if you don't do something. Father, our mindset, God, if you don't do something, our young people are going to lose their souls, God, if you don't do something. Our families are going to be torn apart if you don't do something. We need you here at Belgrade today. We need you in Belgrade today, God. God, I pray for every soul in the city right now that is not here. Every soul that's not here and that is at this altar and in this house. Will you have mercy upon us? Blot out our transgressions. Hide our iniquities. Please forgive us. Have mercy and give us grace that we will be saved. That you will smile upon us again. That you will heal our bodies. That you said by your stripes we are healed. Father, it's been a long time. And God, I said to you, I believe, but help my unbelief. I believe, but help my unbelief. I don't know how you're going to save them. But God, you promised me. You sent me the bell of night and you said, you're going to do it. I just believe. I believe the Holy. I believe that it can change. I can believe it can save us. I believe the waters of baptism can wash away our sins. I believe that we confess our sins unto you. You are faithful enough to forgive us our sins. I believe. So right now, God, heal. As we lay hands, heal. Heal. Heal in the name of Jesus. Set free in the name of Jesus. Touch right now in the name of Jesus. If you got the Holy Ghost, pray in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, set free. In the name of Jesus, set free. Let go in the name of Jesus. I bind the spirit of depression. I bind the spirit of oppression. I bind the spirit. I bind the spirit of rebellion. I bind the spirit of wickedness. I bind the spirit of suicide. I bind it in the name of Jesus. I bind it in the name of Jesus. I bind it in the name of Jesus. I bind it in the spirit of addiction. I bind it in the name of Jesus. Take it out, God. Remove it. Remove it. Remove it, God. The unforgiveness. Remove it, God. The hurt that I've been in. Remove it. God, if we don't forgive, this bitterness, oh God, is going to kill us. This bitterness, God, is going to destroy us. Forgive what they've done. Forgive what they've done. Forgive what they've done. Heal. Heal in the name of Jesus. Heal in the name of Jesus. Protect these children. Protect them in the name of Jesus. God, without you, they can't do it. And the mothers cannot raise them the way that they should. In the name of Jesus, help God. Touch somebody's heart today. That they would understand, God, that they need you. In the name of Jesus. We don't understand. But I pray, God. I ask, God. Heal, God. Heal, Jesus. Heal, Jesus. Just open up your mouth to the Christ. And just say thank you, Jesus. Praise him for the healing. Open up your mouth in this church and thank God for the healing. Praise him if you don't see it. Praise him. Praise him. Tell him, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That's when the healing begins to take place. When you begin to open up your mouth and say thank you. God, I believe it. I believe it. I don't understand, but I believe the healing. I believe it, God. I believe it. I believe it. I believe it. I believe it, I believe it, I believe it. Every tear, he understands every tear. He understands when you feel like worship. Just only believe. I'm not let go. If you don't let go of this Jesus, if you don't let go of the King of Kings, if you don't stop trusting him, I'm here with you. Because I believe it. I believe it. He has to heal you. He has to give you life. Because you've got to put life, more life abundantly. In the name of Jesus, there is something that God wants you to do. You got to give a testimony. But how God gave you and how God healed you. Your testimony is going to change lives. So Lord, heal me for the kingdom of God. Heal me. And we will, Lord, remember and be careful to know that you did it. And when he does it, sis, present every part of your life as a living sacrifice. Holy. Second, because your reason is in the name of Jesus. 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 He's going to take care of you. He's going to take care of you. You may not understand, but believe. If you've never believed like this before, keep moving forward. And keep going towards God in the name of Jesus. Believe it. 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 I just want to pray just a little bit longer. Because I believe God is in this place. I just believe God is here. Just help me to pray just a little bit. Just help me to pray for the Shekinah glory. God, I'm asking you. Lord God, I know that you're here. But do not pass us by. Do not pass us by. We need you in this house. God bless you. Hug somebody as you're leaving today. Tell them you want to see them tonight in Jesus' name. God bless you. We have a soul that's going to go down in the name of Jesus. Come on and help us rejoice unto the Lord about the soul that's going down in the name of Jesus Christ. For God is going to do it. God is able. God is able. Yes. Thank you.
your willingness to identify yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. That burial of your resurrection. I now baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the remission of all of your sins, shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it. Open up your mouth. That's it. Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Come on, the Holy Ghost. Open up your mouth. In the name of Jesus. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus. Father, I pray, God. I pray for her children. I pray for her children, God. In the name of Jesus. Father, what can see the mother do? Father, they can walk in her footsteps. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it, that's it. That's it, that's it, that's it. Let's open up without the Holy Ghost. Let it come. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Clap your hands up to God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, there's somebody else that wants to come. Come on. Come on in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We give God glory. We give God honor and praise. God bless you. God bless you. We love you. And we hope to see you again here in the house of the Lord. Welcome to New Life. You are part of this family in Jesus' name. Amen, amen.
Hey, how you doing?